Welcome students, this is the second part of the topic semiconductor. In this video you will study about the extrinsic semiconductor, its type, the mass action law and its consequences in extrinsic semiconductor. After this I will tell you the important concepts and frequently asked questions from the topic. So please watch the video completely and thoroughly and do not forget to subscribe the channel for more contents. So let's start with the topic. Before going into detail of the extrinsic semiconductor, let's first understand the shortcomings of intrinsic semiconductor. The first one is the free electrons and holes concentration are too low to conduct an appreciable amount of current at room temperature, and also the carrier concentration and so the conductivity is a strong function of temperature, which means that to increase the current you need to increase the temperature, and this is not the desirable feature of any electronic device. Therefore, a method is required to increase the carrier concentration without increasing the temperature, and the solution to this problem is doping. And the semiconductor which is doped is called extrinsic semiconductor. So doping is a process of introduction of impurities into semiconductor crystal using diffusion and ion implantation techniques. It will change the carrier concentration in silicon crystal substantially and in a very precisely controlled manner. Also keeping in mind that doping should increase the carrier concentration of either free electrons and holes, but with little or no change in the crystal properties of silicon. And the doping amount should be 1 impurity atom per 10 to power 6 or 10 to power 8 silicon atoms. Students, as you know that there are two types of current carriers, the electrons and holes. So the extrinsic semiconductor is also two types, the n-type extrinsic semiconductor and p-type extrinsic semiconductor. Now let's study these extrinsic semiconductor in detail, and the first one is n-type extrinsic semiconductor. It is a semiconductor where electrons are the majority carrier of the current. N-type semiconductor is doped with an element with 5 electrons in the valence shell, and these are called pentavalent impurity atom. The pentavalent elements used to dope silicon can be antimony, phosphorus and arsenic. Mostly phosphorus is used as doping atom. Now if you look into the silicon crystal 2D structure, here the 4 electrons of pentavalent atom is equally shared among the 4 neighboring silicon atoms, and 1 extra electron moves freely in the crystal. In this way, free electron concentration gets increased without increasing the temperature. And since pentavalent impurity is donating extra electrons in silicon crystal, it is called donor atom. Here you should note the point that the number of free electrons is almost equal to the number of donor atoms. Why I am saying almost equal, not exactly equal, because there can be some free electrons due to temperature also. But concentration of free electrons is more importantly and effectively determined by the donor atoms. Moving ahead, next is p-type extrinsic semiconductor. It is a semiconductor where holes are the majority carrier of the current. P-type semiconductor is doped with an element of 3 electrons in the valence shell, and these are called trivalent impurity atom. The trivalent atoms used to dope silicon can be boron, gallium and indium. Mostly boron is used as doping atom. Now let's take a look into 2D silicon crystal structure. To complete the covalent bonds with neighboring atoms, the trivalent atom has to take, or you can say accept, 1 electron from some other silicon atom. And this is the reason that trivalent impurity atom is also called as acceptor atom. When it takes an electron, that electron also creates a hole in the silicon crystal. And in this way, holes become majority carrier in the semiconductor, where trivalent impurities have been added. As you have noticed in N-type semiconductor, in same manner, the number of holes are almost equal to the number of acceptor impurity atoms. So let's summarize what are the P-type and N-type extrinsic semiconductors. In P-type, the semiconductor is doped with trivalent impurities. Trivalent impurities are those where 3 electrons are in the valence shell and it is accepting one extra electron to complete the covalent bond sharing among the neighboring silicon atoms, and in this way it is increasing the number of holes. And you have also seen the concentration of holes in P-type silicon is almost equal to the number of acceptor atoms. Similarly, in N-type extrinsic semiconductor, the semiconductor is doped with pentavalent impurities that can be antimony, phosphorus and arsenic. Mostly phosphorus is used, and these pentavalent impurities have 5 electrons in the valence shell, and that's why they donate one extra electron in the crystal. So it is called donor atoms. And it is increasing the number of electrons by donating one extra electron from the valence shell. And you have seen the concentration of free electrons in N-type silicon is almost equal to the number of donor atoms. Now let's see the mass action law. Mass action law for extrinsic semiconductor states that product of majority and minority carriers is constant. And also it is independent of amount of donor and acceptor impurity doping at a fixed temperature. In mathematical format, it is given by this: N into P is equals to Ni square, where Ni is the intrinsic carrier concentration. You have also seen this intrinsic carrier concentration in my previous video on intrinsic semiconductor. Now let's apply the mass action law in N and P type semiconductor. For N type, this mass action law is given by the number of free electrons in N type and product, the number of holes in N type should be equals to Ni square. So we know that the free electrons is almost equal to the number of donor atoms. So you can write it ND product number of holes in N type is equals to Ni square. So you can find out the number of holes in N type semiconductor using the mass action law. And similarly, in P type extrinsic semiconductor, the number of free electrons and the number of holes is product of these two should be equals to Ni square. And we know that the number of holes or the concentration of holes is almost equal to the number of acceptor atoms. So now the number of electrons in P type is given by Ni square upon Na. And these two equations are very important. You are going to use them in many of other analysis. Now let's recall all the important concepts of the topic. The first one is the extrinsic semiconductor is defined as the semiconductor where the carrier concentration is increased by the doping method, and doping is done using diffusion and ion implantation techniques. The doping amount should be one impurity atom per 10 to power 6 to 10 to power 8 silicon atoms. The trivalent extrinsic semiconductor, or you can say the P-type semiconductor, are those semiconductors where holes are the majority carrier of the current. And the pentavalent extrinsic semiconductor, or you can say the N-type semiconductors, are those semiconductors where majority carriers are the electrons. And next is the mass action law. According to the mass action law, the product of the carriers, the majority and minority carriers of a semiconductor is constant and it should be independent of the impurity atoms used to dope the semiconductor. And mathematically it is given by N into P Ni square. And using this mass action law in N type of the semiconductor, we can find out the concentration of holes, and it is given by Ni square upon Nd, where Nd is the number of donor atoms. Similarly, for the P type of the semiconductor, we can find out the number of electrons, which is given by Ni square upon Na, and Na is the number of acceptor atoms. Now let's see the frequently asked questions from the topic. So the first one is, if intrinsic semiconductor can conduct current at room temperature or above, then why doping is required? Because the carrier concentration is a strong function of the temperature, which means we have to increase the temperature to get a good amount of the current. Next is, what are the types of extrinsic semiconductor? These are P-type and N-type. Differentiate between them. I know you can answer this question. What are the consequences of mass action law in N and P-type semiconductor? That you can find out the number of minority carriers in N and P-type of extrinsic semiconductor using the mass action law. And the last one is, consider an N-type silicon for which dopant concentration is 10 to the power 17 per centimeter cube. Find the electron and holes concentrations at temperature 300 Kelvin. So students, the first information is the material is N-type, okay, and dopant concentration is given 10 to the power 17 per centimeter cube. If the material is N-type, which means the electrons will be the majority carriers and the concentration of electron is almost equal to the dopant concentration. So it is given by 10 to power 17 per centimeter cube. This is your first answer. And next is hole concentration. To find the hole concentration at room temperature, we know that Ni is 1.45 10 to power 10 per centimeter cube. Using this value and Nd value, you can find out the concentration of hole for the N-type silicon at 300 Kelvin. So students, I will also present a video where you will find more questions on extrinsic semiconductors which have been and which can be asked in competitive exams. I hope you like the video, so please subscribe the channel for more contents and share it. If you have any queries regarding analog electronic circuit, digital circuit, microprocessors 8085, 8086, microcontroller 8051, embedded systems and VLSI design, you can write me in the comment section or mail me. My mail ID is given in the description of the video. Thank you so much and have a nice day.